Hey guys, welcome back to our channel. So in this video we are gonna see, what if Naruto hated by everyone and trained by himself? This is part 4, and if you want more then please leave like, share and subscribe, let's get in the video. Naruto narrowed his eyes. Is this pity? What I'm feeling for you? The blonde wondered, causing the Sanjenin to look at him confused. Or do I envy you? He continued. All my life, I wondered if my life had any meaning, at least you believe yours had one. But something as sad as that, Naruto's eyes appeared as though they softened. I guess us beggars can't be choosers. He added with a dry laugh. Sakura felt like her heart ached at her teammate's words. Whatever sympathy was there in the blonde's eyes was gone in the next moment as his eyes scornfully said on Gaara. But you endangered my friends, and I can't look away from that, Naruto stated as his blue Sharingan appeared in his eyes. If the Redeed had been intimidated by the strange Sharingan, he was able to hide it perfectly. The deranged Tsuna Genin let out a malicious laugh as he stared right back at the Leaf Genin's glare. That look in your eyes is perfect. Gaara commented as he smiled in glee. I want you to look at me like that until the very moment when I'll spill your blood for mother. The Jinchuriki exclaimed as he thrust butt arms forward in the direction of the blonde. Naruto jumped upwards, but instead of landing on a higher branch, the Konoha Genin used it to propel his body forward, creating enough force to speed past the incoming sand limbs. The blonde Jinchuriki closed his hand as he approached the Redeed. The punch failed, as the Tsuna Shinobi jumped to a different branch before it could connect. Gaara wasted no time to attack. Not giving his opponent a chance to even turn around, the Sanjenin shot his body forward, his claws ready to strike his prey. The blonde jumped back the moment he sensed the incoming attack. Doing a backflip in mid-air to dodge his opponent's attack, the Leaf Genin sunk his feet in Gaara's back as he completed the 360-degree spin, sending the boy down towards the ground. Taking the offensive, Naruto stopped the Redeed's trip downward by graving one of his ankles and swinging the Genin's body towards a tree, breaking the trunk as he flew through. The Tsuna Shinobi stretched his sand claws in order to stop his flight. Landing on a nearby branch, the monstrous Genin glared at the blonde. Is that best you have? The boy exclaimed. Mother and I waited for you after hearing your call, but is this all you have to show for it? Naruto met the Redeed's glare with his own. I guess I'm putting quite a below average performance. The Konoha Nin admitted. I guess it'll be okay if I went a little wild. The moment the words left his mouth, the blonde disappeared from Gaara's sight just to reappear hovering over the Sanjen in the next second and drive his knee into the deranged boy's stomach. Even through the sand protection, Gaara could still feel the force from the blow his stomach received. His breath escaped his lungs, and the Tsuna Nin's head was brought forwards as his body recoiled due to the pain. Blinded because of the strike, the Redeed could not see the fist traveling straight towards his face. The punch's sound was heard throughout the forest as the Sanjenin was thrown flying backwards by its force. Moving at blinding speed, Naruto seemed to disappear again and reappear at the branch Gaara was traveling to. The blonde swung his leg forward, driving his kick into the Redeed's back, stopping the deranged boy's flying trip and causing him to release a scream of pain. The Leaf Genin spun his body around and driving his heel into the Sand Shinobi's gut in a similar fashion to what Sasuke had done before and sending his fellow Jinchuriki flying down towards the ground. The Sharingan user did not waste any time. The boy's hands immediately started on the already familiar set on hand seals. Gekaku no Jutsu. Naruto exclaimed before shooting a sizable fireball down to chase the redhead. The explosion signaled the impact. Before the dust and flames could dissipate, a pair of sand claws shot from the cloud of Rekage, with the blonde Jinchuriki as their target. Jumping to higher branches, Naruto took out a kunai and slashed the pair of monstrous limbs as they approached him. The two arms seemingly started to fall before they suddenly came back to life and reformed themselves before returning to their pursuit of the Konoha Shinobi. Naruto continued to dodge the two transformed limbs until they finally retreated and grabbed a nearby branch in order to pull Gaara back up. Hehehehe. The Redeed started to snicker, but it soon turned into an all-out laugh. That's more like it. He declared. Mother is starting to enjoy this fight. The bloodlust in the Sand Nin's eyes was evident as he looked at the blonde. Let's together make mother happy. The deranged boy shouted as he threw a piece of his sand body into the air. Sabaku aim. The barrage of sand lumps immediately started to fall down on the blonde. The Sharingan user was put on the defensive once again, as all his movements were strictly to evade the flurry of strikes raining down on him. Branches and trunks were reduced to splinters as the onslaught of sand pierced through the trees as it sought to leave Shinobi. Damn it, Naruto cursed, he never expected that he'd be forced to use it so soon into the battle. Amaterasu. The teenaged boy gazed at the sphere of sand above the trees, where all the projectiles originated with his Sharingan eyes. The piece of sand was immediately overwhelmed by black flames that consumed it in a matter of moments, leaving nothing behind to prove that it existed. Gar looked up with a horror-stricken face, as his Zand was reduced to nothing by the black flames. A piece of his mother that had always protected him, simply disappeared in front of the Redeed's eyes, as though it was never even there. Bastard, the words left the boy's lips like a ghostly whisper. You bastard. The Jinchuriki's eyes set on the blonde in front of him, yellow eyes blazing in fury as they burned into the leaf genin. The spiky-haired boy hadn't felt such a strong killer intent since Itachi. Shifting his body slightly to the side, Naruto was able to hide the shaking in his hand. How dare you try to take mother away from me? The transformed Tsuna Shinobi shouted as his killer intent kept on rising. Mother is the only one important to me in this world. The only one that never deserted me and always remained by my side. The words roared through the forest, making some of the people present cringe at the fury they held. Mother is all I have. Gaara declared. Naruto remained silent for a couple of moments as his gaze regarded the Redeed in front of him. All you have? The blonde simply repeated. Suddenly, a matching killer intent emanated from the Konohanin as his eyes narrowed, forming a glare directed to the other Jinchuriki. In less than a second, Naruto had moved in front of Gaara and drove his fist into the Sand Genin's cheek, sending him flying back once again. Two spiky-haired clones appeared ready to receive the airborne boy. Using his Sharingan, Sasuke could follow as the three identical leaf genins trashed the deranged Redeed around trees and branches. What surprised the raven-haired boy the most was not his teammate's impressive physical strength, nor the blinding speed of his movements, but the look that the one smiling face held. As much as Gaara's look carried dementia less than 5 minutes ago, Naruto's was now pure anger and disdain. Something that the Tsuna Shinobi had said had made the former loudmouth snapped, sending the boy into a raging frenzy. A powerful kick sent the transformed teenager flying through numerous tree trunks, finally stopping several feet away. That thing is not all you have, the blonde's words were full of contempt. You have siblings, you have a family, you were probably even able to meet your father. Naruto closed his fist to try to stop the furious shaking. So don't come here and tell me that that thing inside you is all you have when you have pushed away everything else around you. His teeth were gritting now and his voice was coming out strained due to the anger. You had so much yet you still chose to become like this, you chose to be feared over than loved, the Jinchuriki's voice started to die out. It's because of you, it's because of people like you that I had, the teenage boy never finished the sentence, as his hand suddenly went through the required hand seals, and another fireball was released in direction of the Redeed. The swiftness of the attack caught the Redeed by surprise. Gaara could only bring his arms forward to protect himself as the flames engulfed his body. The impact of the fire jutsu was enough to send the Sand Genin flying a few branches back. I really hate people like you, Naruto declared as he glared at the deformed boy in front of him trying to stand back up. People that thrive of the knowledge of being feared. You claim being alone in this world, but the truth is that you view yourself above all other. Things that the blonde thought he had under control were running wild now. Locking yourself inside a barrier of sand and trying to sound like a victim, you don't know what real pain is, what it feels like to be betrayed by the few things you thought you had. Shut up. The Redeed boy interrupted. His eyes set on the blonde holding a mixture of anger and sorrow. You don't know anything about me. The Tsuna Shinobi shot back. You don't know all I had to go through, and how, at the very end, mother was the only one that remained by my side. The Jinchuriki's voice came out strained as memories plagued his mind. This is it, please die. Suddenly, Gaara's killer intent returned full force. Betrayal? His strange yellow eyes glared at the blonde. Don't you dare speak to me about betrayal. Anger flooded out of the transformed boy as his breath started to come out strained. I'll never let anyone else betray me. The Sand Nin exclaimed before he thrust his arms forward. Monstrous limbs shot towards the spiky-haired boy, forcing him to jump from branch to branch, in order to avoid their devastating rampage. The hatred that had been harbored in the blonde's eyes had now transferred to the Redeed's as he continued to tear through trees and branches. I'll push everyone. I'll push everyone away. I won't allow them to get a chance to betray me again. He declared before retreating his sand claws, and the mouths appeared on his body again. Mugen Sajin Ditapa. The powerful gust of wind and sand erupted from the Jinchuriki's mouths. Naruto immediately jumped behind a thick tree in order to escape the savage burst of dust that swept through the forest. A sand claw went through the trunk that the blonde was hiding behind, causing the leaf nin to jump to another branch to escape the monstrous limb that followed him. "I'll destroy everyone in my path. I'll offer all of their blood to Mother and prove that I exist in this world," Gaara announced in his crazed rage. "To prove that I was betrayed and that I will take my revenge on the world," he exclaimed as his transformed arms continued to chase his opponent. Without stopping his movements, the Konoha genin was able to set an eyes on the other Jinchuriki. "I really can't forgive people like you," he stated as he jumped to a new branch seconds before the one he had been standing on was destroyed by the pursuing claw. "Letting the rage and bloodlust consume you and turning into the demons they fear us to be," the teenage boy added. "Shut up," the Redeed shouted. "You don't know anything about me." The speed of the sand claw suddenly increased, managing to grab a hold of the Sharingan user and slamming his body against a tree. Less than a second afterwards, the sand was already starting to cover his body. "I'll kill you. I'll kill you for the disrespect you have shown Mother and me," Gaara declared as his eyes glared at the blonde. Despite his seemingly imminent death, the spiky-haired boy merely continued to observe the sand genin. "I met a guy just a few months ago," Naruto started. "He showed me a hell that now haunts my nightmare, but I tried, and I'm still trying, to look past all the things I saw in that place," the leaf shinobi revealed as his eyes narrowed. "And now I meet someone like you, who has given up and thrown himself into the depths of madness with foolish thoughts of retribution." A dark blue chakra started to emanate from the blonde's body. "It irks me to no end knowing that you have given up on the world so easily." With the boy's outburst, the navy chakra burst, freeing the Sharingan user from the sand. "I really can't forgive you right now," he said as he set his eyes on the Redeed in front of him. The two Jinchurikas glared at each other before dashing off forward. Blows were exchanged in mid-air. Flashback. "You know, you really didn't have to accompany me shopping." A small black-haired boy looked up at the young woman next to him before answering. "Aka-san is worried about you since you have been going out so much lately, so I offered to come with you," 4-year-old Itachi simply stated. Ichiha Kagome sighed as she looked at her cousin's oldest child. "You do know that I'm a jounin, right? If anyone is doing any babysitting, it's me looking after you," she tried to explain. "Rank doesn't really matter, a well-trained chunin could sneak up on even a kage, if the target's unaware and alone," Itachi merely said as he continued to walk. "Do you expect me to be attacked by a group chunin in the middle of the village?" she asked. The boy's eyes didn't even shift from the path ahead. "Please don't put words in my mouth, Kagome-nisen," Itachi shot back. "I said a chunin, not a group. Besides, I've seen you sparing, if you're distracted enough, you won't even see a genin coming." To say the least, the young woman was bewildered by 4-year-old statement. "Hey. I already told you that there was a specific reason why I did so poorly in that sparing match," she tried to defend herself. "Then, what is it?" "I told you, I can't tell you right now, you're too young. For a leaf Kunoichi, you sure make a lot of excuses, it's not fitting," the black-haired boy commented. Another sigh escaped Kagome, she should have known better than to get into an argument the Uchiha clan's resident genius. Uchiha Itachi will make a great shinobi someday, she was sure of it, but for now, he was nothing more than a know-it-all kid that could go against experienced adults in a myriad variety of discussions and still come out making them look silly. She had grown really close to the boy, especially after Obito's tragedy, but that terrible weapon of destruction he called his mind did put a strain in their relationship. "Well, fancy meeting you here." Both Uchiha turned to look at the sudden interruption. Casually walking towards the two black-haired relatives was one Namaka's Minato with what had become a trademark for the blonde man, a grin adorning his face. "Minato-san," Kagome called out. ANC the ending note for explanation. Itachi couldn't help but raise an eyebrow at the sudden excitement in his cousin's voice at the sight of the already legendary jounin. "How are you on this fine day, Kagome-san?" the young man asked as he gave the black-haired woman a small courteous bow. The giggle that escaped the young woman almost made Itachi kick her in the shin and make a run for it. One thing that the 4-year-old boy really didn't want to see at the moment was his cousin acting all girly. Minato's gaze lowered to set on younger Uchiha. "And what about you, Itachi-kun? Your name is coming up again and again as of lately, Fugaku-san and Makoto-san must be really proud," the blonde man commented as he ruffled the boy's hair. Itachi's glare immediately set on the man in front of him. It was certain that the 4-year-old Uchiha was incredibly mature for his age. He was well aware that most people were both amazed and annoyed by his intellect. He could deal with anything or anyone without losing his composure. Anyone except Namaka's Minato. Something about the Konoha yellow flash always managed to get on the boy's nerves. Swiping his hand, the black-haired kid pushed the man's hand away. "Well, it seems that we still have the attitude problems to deal with," Minato commented, unfazed by the young boy's actions. "I guess it's just normal for you to be jealous, after all, I'm already a renowned shinobi, while you're still a little kid with a kunai play set," he said as he straightened his body and stood proudly. A snort escaped the 4-year-old. "Yeah, like I'm supposed to be envious of you. I've already heard about the incident between you, Horatian, and the waterfall." The boy shook his head to add to the insult. "Seriously, it's just a matter of time before you find yourself falling in a volcano or something. Hey, watch it, you brat." That only happened while Horatian no jutsu was still on its development stages, and stop gossiping with Jiraiya-sensei. Minato shot back, already falling into the boy's game. "Oh, touched a sore spot, didn't we? And what was that about you blowing up the bull's corral while practicing that spiral sphere of yours?" Itachi asked, his voice fully tainted by a mocking tone. The blonde man gave a small grunt. "Like I have to explain my genius to you. Only a sorry shinobi would have such a sorry excuse," the black-haired boy commented. "Do you have something to say, you little punk?" "As a matter of fact, yes. I want you to remain in that little throne of yours until I become a shinobi and beat you up myself." The blonde man and the black-haired boy glared at each other intensively. "I accept that challenge. Hurry up, I don't want to wait too long for the day that I can finally kick your ass." "Namaka's Minato." Kagome suddenly interrupted the argument. "Are you really engaging in such childish fights against a 4-year-old? And losing too," Itachi added. The young woman gave her cousin a warning look before her eyes set back on the yellow flash, whose face had turned red out of embarrassment, and his eyes looked at everything but Kagome. He started, it was all that the man could say. Kagome sighed in exasperation. "You've got to be kidding me." Itachi watched in curiosity as Minato tried to explain himself to his cousin. For some reason, it was while talking to the blonde jounin that Kagome seemed the happiest she had appeared ever since Obito's. What was it about Namaka's Minato that could possibly bring such a smile to Uchiha Kagome's face? End flashback. A pair of onyx eyes opened to look at the rain falling into the ground. Uchiha Itachi stood in one of the entrances to the Akatsuki base pondering on his sudden remembrance. "Why am I remembering something like that now?" the young man thought. As of late, Itachi's head had been plagued by his blonde target and the events of the night of their meeting, the image of the blue Sharingan, seared into black-haired man's mind. The Akatsuki member had tried a basic meditation exercise to try to clear his head when the old memory found its way into the surface. Suddenly, realization hit him. Could it be? His train of thought was unfortunately cut off by the sound of approaching steps. Looking up, Itachi could see his blue-skinned companion walking towards him. "There you are," he said once he reached the black-haired man. "I've been looking everywhere for you. The others told me that you got our new orders," Kizum commented. The Sharingan user nodded. "Yes," he answered. "We are to go to Konoha once again," the Uchiha added before simply walking into the rain. The former Kirin follow his black-haired companion. "Goody, I finally get chance to meet the kid that kicked your ass a couple of months ago," he said. Itachi remained silent at the swordsman's words. "I really don't know if I should capture him or thank him," Kizum remarked, adding a chuckle for effect. The Uchiha was able to keep himself in check as he continued to walk. "I mean, the great Itachi being defeated, no, humiliated, by a genin brat. When I heard about it I thought it was my birthday," the shark-like man commented before starting to laugh. "Haha, I really wish I could have been there to see your face," he managed to add between his laughter. The Sharingan user didn't even stop, nor did his voice carry any sign of frustration. "Keep it up," he started. "And when you fall asleep I'll just take you down the pier and trade you for 10 boxes of Pocky, again," Itachi warned, earning a glare from the former Mist Shinobi. A tree came crashing down as the Redeed's transformed body went through its trunk. Naruto stood panting on a branch as the Sand Nin's body was completely engulfed by dust. Scattered wood, burn marks, and craters laid throughout the forest as evidence of the fight between the two Jinchuriki. "What's going on?" At the sound of a new voice at the scene, Kankuro turned around to see Temari landing on a branch he had been standing. A sigh of relief escaped the puppet user at the sight of the blonde girl. Well, as you can see, the scenario is getting worse by the second. Something about that guy is just irking Gaara further and further. He said before looking at his older sister skeptically. How come it took you so long to get here? The brown-haired boy asked. Surprising Kankuro, a blush appeared on the Suna Kunoichi. None of your business. She declared, looking away from her brother. Shrugging his sister reaction off, the boy set his eyes back on the fight between the two apparent monsters. Just like the blonde had expected it, a sandclaw appeared flying towards him. After jumping into a higher branch, the leaf genin started to move in the direction of the deranged boy. Gaara looked up to see his opponent's foot about to connect with his face. Once again, the sand coat had been virtually useless in trying to block the pain. Before the kick could send the Redeed's body flying back, Naruto grabbed one of the transformed arms and swung the monster's body, slamming the Suna genin into a tree. The spiky-haired boy followed by delivering a devastating uppercut under Gaara's chin, causing his body to lift off from the ground. Catching the rising body but the ankle, the Konoha Shinobi slammed the Redeed back into the ground before jumping into the air and starting on a set of hand seals. And in Kawano Jutsu, he called out before a blast of heat shot towards Gaara's transformed body, an explosion followed. The new cloud of dust and rubble was big enough to engulf some of the trees. Jumping to one of the highest branches, Naruto waited once more. Suna Shuriken. The barrage of sand projectiles appeared through the cloud of dust, destroying several trees on their way out. The blonde genin jumped higher up as his hands went through the necessary seals. House Kano Jutsu. A barrage of small fireballs met with the sand shuriken, canceling each other out. As Naruto's feet were about to touch a branch, one of Redeed's transformed arms came crashing through, forcing the spiky-haired boy to create a clone to change his direction in mid-air. The moment when the leaf shinobi was finally able to land, the pain that had been bothering him for the last few months suddenly shot through his body, paralyzing the boy just as the second claw approached. Standing helplessly on a branch, the boy could do nothing to defend himself as the monstrous limb grabbed him by the arm and forcibly pulled him towards the source. Naruto found himself looking directly at Gaara's eyes. In his desperation, the Konoha nin didn't think twice. Tsukiyomi. Immediately, all the sand left the Redeed's body. The Suna genin tried to move as terror invaded his face, just to find himself unable to move. What's going on? The Jinchuriki exclaimed. He was no longer in the Konoha forest, but in some sort of dark wasteland. What have you done with mother? Standing a couple of feet away, the blonde simply glared at the Redeed. Your mother won't be able to manifest in here, the genin stated. This is a place where all of your sins come back to pass judgment. A katana appeared between the two Jinchuriki. This is my world. Naruto took a hold of the sword. This is my hell, he said before thrusting the blade forward. Blue Sharingan eyes widened when the sword was stopped less than an inch from the Suna Shinobi by the sand that had supposed to have disappeared. A wicked smile appeared on Gaara's face as his body was covered by the sand once more, returning to the raccoon-like form. I told you, the Redeed's voice carried an ominous yet mocking tone. Mother will never desert me. Suddenly, Naruto was violently pushed back by an unseeing force as he found himself out of the Tsukiyomi mindscape. Finally stopping by hitting a tree, the blonde felt a new pain coursing through his body, this time originating from his eyes. Damn it, the scroll warned that this would happen if Tsukiyomi was rejected, the boy whispered to himself as he clenched his head. It must have been the one tail's doing, he commented, still trying to shake off the Jinjutsu's recoil. Hahaha. Gaara's demented laugh sounded through the forest. Was that your hell? The Redeed asked as his chakra started to spike. Then allow me to bring mine out here. The blonde could only watch dumbfounded as sand suddenly skyrocketed from the Suna genin's body and took the form of a giant raccoon. The enormous monstrosity roared, causing several of the trees in the surrounding area to shake. And massive claw started to move towards the still thunderstruck boy. Naruto. Sakura screamed as she saw that her teammate wasn't about to move. At the sound of her voice, the monstrous creature shifted its eyes towards the girl. A piece of sand unexpectedly shot towards the pink-haired Kunoichi, catching her by surprise and slamming her body against a tree. Sakura. Sasuke, Shikamaru, and Shino shouted at the same time. The three boys immediately jumped towards the now unconscious girl. Reaching his former classmate first, Shino tried to get rid of the sand that was currently choking her by using his bugs. To the genin's dismay, the Kikai Mushi could not digest the chakra in the sand. Can you get her out? Shigemaru asked as he arrived. Shino was about to answer his friend when suddenly the sand came back to life and trapped the two black-haired boys. "Guys!" Sasuke exclaimed as his body got closer to his trapped comrades. Managing to free one of his legs, Shikamaru kicked the incoming Uchiha away, saving the raven-haired from being trapped by the sand. Naruto realized that his body was now shaking, though not out of pain or shock, but of pure anger and rage. "Damn you," he said as he looked up at the enormous raccoon. "This fight is between the two of us. You didn't need to get them involved," the blonde shouted. The monster's only reaction was to laugh at the Konoha nin's words before starting to reach for the boy again. "You'll pay," the leaf genin couldn't hold back his rage anymore as the sand claw was almost over him. "I'm going to make you pay," the navy blue chakra engulfed his body once more. "I'm going to make you pay for hurting them," Naruto exclaimed as his hand automatically started on a set of hand seals. Kuchiyu's no jutsu. A giant cloud of smoke went off in the forest. "Naruto, you better have a damn good reason for summoning me," Gamabunta commented as the smoke around his body started to dissipate. "I'm sorry," Gamabunta-sama, the blonde apologized as he stood on top of the toad boss's head, the dark blue chakra still emanating throughout his body. "But this guy just really got on my nerves." The genin's voice had become low and quiet, yet it still held something powerful. "And I just feel like knocking some sense into him." The toad looked at the monstrous raccoon standing in front of him. "I see," Gamabunta sighed as he put his pipe away. "But you owe me one," he added as he unsheathed his sword and pointed its blade at the sand creature. The monster brought its arm forward, both claws immediately shot towards the enormous toad. Jumping high in the sky, Gamabunta prepared to strike the sand creature down with his sword. Looking up at the toad boss, the raccoon shot a barrage of what appeared to be wind blasts. Tebidama no jutsu. The brownish amphibious countered, releasing several water bullets to intercept the incoming attack. Wind and water meet in mid-air, the toad's technique managed to stop all the blasts but one. Naruto. Hearing his cue, the blonde prepared his own attack. Gekaku no jutsu. The last wind projectile was taken care of by the genin's fireball. Landing on the other side of the raccoon, Gamabunta immediately shot forward with his sword ready. At the last second, the monster turned around and brought one of its arm up to block the blade strike. The toad boss immediately took the chance and moved his head up, giving the boy that summoned him an opening. Entenkawa no jutsu. Naruto exclaimed, releasing another powerful blast of heat towards the raccoon's head. Unfortunately for the team of toad and boy, the sand monster managed to bring its other arm up to shield himself, at the cost of the limb. Ha ha ha. A deformed version of Gaara's laughter was heard coming from the gigantic creature. "Is this how you were going to make me pay, Naruto-kun?" the Redeed's voice mocked. "Rinkuiden!" the Jinchuriki exclaimed before releasing another set of air bullets. Gamabunta immediately jumped back to evade the wind-based attack. "I'm not really sure you're worth all the trouble," Naruto the amphibious commented as he brought his sword forward, just in case the sand creature launched a sudden attack. "Please, Gamabunta-sama, just give me one more opening," the blonde requested. The toad boss gave an exasperated sigh, but still charged forward. Laughter was the deformed genin's first response. "That's it? Come on. Mother and I can't wait to spill all of you blood," the boy exclaimed from somewhere inside the enormous creature. Just like before, the sand monster blocked the incoming sword strike with its good arm, but this time, as the Jinchuriki started to raise his other limb for the second strike, Gamabunta opted to turn his head towards the wounded arm. "Tebidama," he said before releasing a barrage of water balls, hardening sand that formed the extremity and causing it to break up, before he left the stage to the Konoha Shinobi. Set on taking full advantage of his second chance, the spiky-haired boy wasted no time in forming the necessary hand seals for another attack. Entenkawa no jutsu. Acting on instinct, the monstrous creature stretched his body in order for his head to escape the blast. The Katen jutsu instead created a hole through the Jinchuriki's chest. Gaara screamed in pain from the attack. Immediately, the monster's tail moved on its own and went around its body to strike the toad. Seeing the attack coming, the amphibious jumped back in the air. Once airborne, Gamabunta set his eyes down on the sand creature. To say the least, the toad boss was getting tired of the demented Jinchuriki. "Naruto, I'm going to take the initiative for a bit," he informed before releasing a stream of oil on the raccoon, successfully distracting the creature and allowing the brownish toad to strike down with his sword, severing the remaining monstrous arm. The victory was short-lived. When Gamabunta looked up at his opponent, his eyes widened in surprise as the Jinchuriki's deformed body suddenly opened and lunged forward to swallow the toad boss. Thinking quickly, the amphibious shook his head back, throwing the blonde out of Hammer's way, as he continued to fight off the sand that was trying to engulf him. Gamabunta-sama! Naruto shouted as he created a shadow clone in order to break his fall and jump towards the mass of sand that was currently Gaara. Before the leaf genin could even take a kunai out, a new sand claw suddenly sprouted from the mass and shot toward the blonde, catching the boy in mid-air and driving him straight into the ground. Sapphire eyes slowly opened as Naruto found his body in the forests, or what was left of it, ground while the sand engulfed his body. Look! The Redeed's voice came out, excited. Gazing around, the blonde's eyes soon set on what the Tsunenin was referring to. The sight of the unconscious Akura and the barely conscious Shikamaru and Shino being crushed by the sand that encased them, while a weakened Sasuke tried to use House Can to free them, but failing due to the lack of chakra. They're all going to die soon, Gaara announced. And you can't do a thing about it, the glee was evident in the Sand Genin's voice. I'm going to take them away from you and offer them to Mother. The sand was now covering most of the blonde's body by now. Naruto's eyes pleadingly gazed at his comrades, hoping for a miracle to happen and save them. I'm not strong enough to save them, the sand was already starting to cover Genin's neck. It's just like that fox mask, I'm unable to protect the things that the sand was now reaching his face. I want to keep them safe, I want to protect them, because images of the few pleasant memories that the boy had flooded into his mind. With sudden gasp, the Jinchuriki realized how much most of those memories he had shared with his comrades, no, with his friends mean. I won't let you hurt them. Gaara. Naruto declared, by now most of his face was already covered by sand. Because they are all I have. The Sora Sharingan returned to the blonde's last visible eyes and set on the abomination over him. Amaterasu. Taking most of the boy's remaining chakra, the black flames engulfed the gigantic mass of sand. A-A-A-H-H-H. Gaara screamed as the flames spread through his deformed body. Mother! Mother! The monstrous creature backed away from the toad as the dark fire continued to consume his body. Naruto, are you okay? Gamabunta asked as he looked down at the boy that was struggling to get up. Take easy, it's over now, the toad boss stated, knowing quite well the effects of the Amaterasu flames and what would be the Sanjin Shuriki's ultimate fate. The blonde shook his head. No, I have one more, the Konoha Genin stated as he began to pull up his right sleeve and revealing a bandaged forearm. Gamabunta's eyes widened at realization. Are you sure you can pull it off? The amphibious asked with concern. Nodding, Naruto looked up at the enormous toad. Yeah, but I'm going to need a lift. At the boy's words, the toad boss sighed and lowered one of his hands. Okay, get on. The leaf nin proceeded to jump on the toad's palm. After stretching his arm back, Gamabunta shot the young Jinchuriki towards the burning raccoon with all his strength. I only have one shot at this, Naruto thought as he tore the bandages in his arm to give view to a summoning tattoo. Smearing the mark with blood from one of his wounds and gathering his remaining chakra, the blonde preformed the necessary hand seals. Namaka's Kuchiyu's no jutsu. Just as Naruto was about to reach Gaara, both Jinchuriki were swallowed up by a blinding light. The leaf nin proceeded to jump on the toad's palm. After stretching his arm back, Gamabunta shot the young Jinchuriki towards the burning raccoon with all his strength. I only have one shot at this, Naruto thought as he tore the bandages in his arm to give view to a summoning tattoo. Smearing the mark with blood from one of his wounds and gathering his remaining chakra, the blonde preformed the necessary hand seals. Namaka's Kuchiyu's no jutsu. Just as Naruto was about to reach Gaara, both Jinchuriki were swallowed up by a blinding light. Gamabunta let out a sigh as he watched the lustrous flare. Just like Minato, the toad boss commented as he took his smoke pipe back out. Gamabunta could feel the summoning jutsu wearing off. The last thing that the enormous toad saw before returning to his world was the gigantic body of sand starting to break down and dissolving as it fell into the ground. Kankuro watched in shock and amazement as the light and the black flames faded away, leaving a cloud of dust in the middle of the clearing. Gaara was defeated, the puppet user managed to say in utter bewilderment. Down in the clearing, Gaara was equally surprised when he found himself standing back on the ground. His body was extremely weakened, and his legs were about to give up at any moment, but, despite what the Redeed had thought a couple of seconds before, he was still pretty much alive. Why? Why did you stop those flames? The Tsunade Jinchuriki asked the boy standing in front of him, as the blonde's image appeared through the dissipating dust. Ragged breathing followed by a low laugh were the initial answers to Gaara's question. I already told you I can't forgive you right now, Naruto answered as his Sharingan eyes set on the Redeed's light blue ones. The right thing to do is give you a chance to change, after all, everyone is supposed to deserve at least one, right? The inquiry was received by a scoff. Supposedly, yes, suddenly, the Sand Genin's eyes narrowed. But what makes you think I'll change? There's no way that you can make me betray mother. Stop calling him your mother already. Naruto exclaimed as he brought up one of his hand to rub his temple. I get all sorts of disturbing images when you call the Bijuu by that term, the blonde commented. Anger resurfaced inside Gaara at the Konoha Nin's words. Shut up. You don't understand the bond between mother and me. You don't understand anything. Baka. Naruto's outburst silenced the Redeed. It's you who doesn't understand. As carriers we are discriminated by others, I spent most of my life trying to change their views, trying to show that I wasn't some sort of demon to be feared and hated, yet you. By choosing that thing over anything else, prove their perception of us right. The boy exclaimed as his Sharingan eyes narrowed on the Tsuna Genin. There's a world out there apart from the Bijuu, I know, this eyes have seen it, and I already used my chance to try to reach it abruptly, Naruto's voice went quiet. The Lee Shinobi silent immediately caught Gaara's attention. You failed? The Redeed wondered. A dry laugh followed the question again. I don't really know, the blonde admitted. I ended up turning into someone who doesn't really know what he wants anymore. Naruto commented. It's like I'm stuck in a crossroad without knowing where either path will take me, the spiky-haired boy let out another humorless laugh. Funny isn't it, here I am trying to get my point across to you, while I don't really know what it is myself. Naruto added before his eyes narrowed once again. But what I do know is that I will protect my comrades and teammates no matter what, because they are all I have. Gaara stood silently as he regarded his fellow Jinchuriki, and trying to match the glare he was receiving. You have a better shot than I did. The blonde said as his glare weakened. You have people that will stay by your side at any given time. Gaara was surprised when the other boy's gaze moved up to look at Kankuro and Temari standing on the branches. They've proven how much they truly worry about you, the Leaf Genin commented. Gaara scoffed again. Care for me? He repeated. All my life, I have known nothing but apathy and disdain from them. The Redeed stated as he glared at the blonde Jinchuriki. Naruto appeared unfazed by the Sand Nin's outburst. Yet, they are still here, the spiky-haired boy simply said. They could have left you behind at any point during our fight, but instead, they decided to remain here for you. It's just that you're too blind to see their worried faces. At the blonde's words, Gaara couldn't help but force his neck to turn his head around, so that he could look at his siblings. Temari's hand gripped the part of her cloth that laid over her heart, while Kankuro's slight inclination forward of his body was enough for the Redeed to know that the puppet user was about to come forward to his aid at any time. You and your mother are the ones that are keeping them so far away. The sound of Naruto's voice snapped the Sand Genin's attention back to the blonde. You have a real opportunity to change your ways. The Jinchuriki stated. I know how difficult the villagers in Tsuna must be, they're the same here in Konoha, but don't do it for them, instead do it for the people you care about, and those that care about you, because they are worth it. The Redeed boy found no retort to the Leaf Genin's words, not even mother had an answer for him. Hey, you're really something, Gaara managed to let out after a while. Maybe this is why I wanted to fight you so much? I guess I needed to find an enemy like you, the Tsuna Nin commented as he regarded the other Jinchuriki. Naruto simply shook his head at Gaara's words. No, we are too similar to be enemies, at least that's what I hope. The blonde stated. You just need to work on your social skills. Something between a smirk and a smile appeared on the Sand Shinobi's face. For someone that tries to appear so cold, you really have a positive look of the world, the Redeed commented, he could already feel his body about to give up. Looking at the Konoha Genin one more time, Gaara sighed. I wonder if I should feel jealous of you, his vision faded into darkness. Taking a step forward, the blonde caught the Sand Genin's body. No, you shouldn't, the Sharingan user said as he looked down at the unconscious Redeed. I'm just looking up a well, Naruto commented. Two soft sounds caught the blonde's attention, causing the spiky-haired boy to look up. Both, Kankuro and Temari, stood at the edge of the clearing regarding the two Jinchuriki with caution. Naruto's Sharingan eyes set on the two siblings. I'd suggest you take Gaara and get out of the village before the Anbu find you, but if you're looking for a fight, the Jinchuriki's voice carried a menacing tone. I have more than enough energy for the both of you. he added as his eyes narrowed, though he was silently trying to force his body not to give up. "We both do," Sasuke's voice announced as the raven-haired boy landed next to the blonde. "The others are safe. Shikamaru is taking Sakura back to the village already," the Uchiha informed his teammate. Nodding at his teammate's words, the spiky-haired boy turned to look at the sand ninjas again, daring them to make a hostile move. Taking a deep breath, Kankuro started to move forward, keeping his hands visible to the two leaf genins. Standing in front of the guy that defeated his brother, the puppet user received a small nod of acknowledgement from the blonde, followed by his younger brother's body. Not wasting any time, Kankuro and Tamari jumped up on a tree and soon disappeared from view. Letting out an exhausted sigh, Naruto had to use his own knees for support to prevent his body from falling to the ground. "Nice tough guy image, I almost bought it for a second," Sasuke's voice broke the silence in the clearing. Snapping out of his trance, the blonde looked up to find, to his surprise, his teammate's hand extended towards him. Letting out a small laugh while shaking his head, the spiky-haired boy took the other Sharingan user's hand. The raven-haired boy swung his teammate's arm over his shoulder in order to support him better. "You know, I can still walk by myself," Naruto commented as the two of them started on their way. "Yeah right, you can barely stand, let alone walk. If I wanted to, I could just let you fall into the ground. And I could easily trip you right now. Either way you'll end up on the ground," Sasuke countered. A smirk appeared on Naruto's face. "Yeah, but I believe I'd feel a lot better with you by my side," the boy commented, giving his relative a small smirk and receiving one back. Sasuke, the blonde's face suddenly turned serious. "About my Sharingan." "Save it," the raven-haired genin interrupted. "We can talk about it later," he added, keeping his eyes on their path. The smirk returned to Naruto's face. "I was just going to say that mine is stronger than yours," the genin stated. A scoff escaped the Uchiha. "I doubt it." Naruto's smirk grew slightly. "I'm not kidding," the blonde began once again. "I've seen what you can do with yours, and it's just—" Suddenly, the spiky-haired boy went silent and his hand shot towards his chest. "Are you alright?" Sasuke asked as he noticed the change on his teammate. The Jinchuriki gripped his shirt, this was just like what he had felt that morning before the exam. "Yeah, I'm alright," the blonde lied, because deep down, he knew that something terrible had just happened. "Where's Naruto? Is he coming at all?" Sakura asked, unable to lift her eyes from the rain-soaked floor. A couple of feet ahead of her, the last group of villagers were finishing paying their last respects to their fallen Hokage. Managing to glance at the pink-haired girl beside him for a few seconds, Sasuke's eyes immediately shifted back to the grieving procession. "I don't know," it took the boy a couple of moments to elaborate. "I haven't seen him much since. In fact, I haven't seen him at all since we found out." It still haunted the young Uchiha's mind, the memory from when he and his blonde teammate had made it back to the village after their intense battle with Gaara. They had been met by Shikamaru's father, apparently Sakura, and the others had already been taken in to receive medical attention. Shikaku had tried to lay it on the two genins as gently as he possibly could, Sasuke now thanked him for that, but still, when the moment came to reveal the terrible truth. The raven-haired boy could clearly recall how his teammate had gone eerily quiet, and still for well over a minute, before giving some poor excuse and going off without receiving any treatment, and before anyone could stop him. Sasuke had gone against his usual nature and had tried to talk to Naruto during the couple of days after the events. Most of the times, he was sure that the blonde was in the apartment, but had decided to ignore his knocks on the doors. "I'm worried," Sakura spoke again. "No one has seen him since that day. If he isn't even coming to the funeral, then he might be. He came before the ceremony started." The two genins looked at the source of the voice. Kakashi had suddenly appeared next to his students. "I saw him come by while I was here earlier," the Jounin's eye scanned the mourning congregation. "I guess he preferred to show his respect in private. I can relate to those feelings," the silver-haired man shared. The raven-haired boy nodded at his teacher's words. Silent engulfed the three-leaf ninjas for the next couple of seconds, until Sasuke suddenly turned to face his sensei. "Wait, are you telling me that you were actually here on time, but then you left just so that you could be late?" the boy asked the other Sharingan user. The bored look on Kakashi's face didn't even waver. "You could say that," the Jounin answered simply. The fact that they were in the middle of the ceremony to pay tribute to their fallen comrades was the only thing that kept the Uchiha from attacking his teacher. Shaking the violent ideas off, Sasuke turned back to the service. "So, Naruto, are you finally going to tell me what your dream is?" The flames started to consume their surroundings. I'm going to be Hokage someday. You better take care of that hat, because someday it's going to be mine. They simply engulfed all in their path, reducing everything to ashes. You want to be Hokage because of the hat? No, I want to become Hokage, so that I can protect the whole village, that way, everyone would look up to me. Plus, I like the hat. Hehehe, that's a nice dream, Naruto, but, why didn't you want to tell me? The flames destroyed everything, except for the memories. Because you kept asking for my dream, and becoming Hokage is my goal. Hehehe, I almost believe you when you say it with such confidence. What? What do you mean almost? I will become Hokage. Why wouldn't those memories disappear? Why couldn't the flames get rid of them? Never change, Naruto, no matter what may happen in this world, always retain your vibrant spirit and bright smile, remember that. Why wasn't he here anymore to catch him if he fell? The flames continued to devour everything in their paths, except for the memories that seared the boy's heart. No one felt like talking afterwards. It was as if all the villagers had come into an unspoken agreement as they started on their way home. He's stronger. Sasuke's words cut through the silence. Giving her teammate a curious look through her saddened eyes, Sakura waited for the raven-haired boy to elaborate. Naruto, he has become stronger than me. Just as she was about to ask the Uchiha how he could possibly think about something like that in a moment like this one, the pink-haired Kunoichi felt a hand on her shoulder. Looking back at her sensei, the girl understood the message he was trying to get through. In time like these, people tend to want to talk about anything but the matter in front of them. A light chuckle snapped Sakura out of her thoughts. Looking around, the girl was surprised to find the source. Hehe, I remember a long time ago Sasuke started as his onyx-colored eyes looked up. The Sand Dame told me that one of the hardest things to do for someone that was born talented was to find a suitable rival, someone who could become a goal to be reached. I think Naruto has become that for me, the boy admitted. Sakura wasn't sure what to make of the raven-haired genin's words. One part of her was happy that Sasuke was opening up and sharing this with her, but the other was terrified of the prospect of her teammates fighting again. The memories from the Forest of Death came rushing back into her mind. Sakura, the pink-haired girl, was taken back when the Uchiha suddenly turned to look directly at her. Thank you about warning me not to face Naruto. Sasuke looked down at his hands before closing them into fists. I'm not sure about what happened last time, but it's now clear to me that a fight between the two of us would have ended in my defeat or even worse. The raven-haired boy left the sentence unfinished as he continued. Both, Naruto and I, still have much maturing to do. We have many issues to solve before we finally meet each other across an arena, and until that day comes, I will keep on moving forward, so I'll be able to protect what I care about, just like Naruto did when he fought Gaara. The Sharingan eyes set on Sakura once again. The Kunoichi was taken back once again by her teammate's words, but before she could think of something so say, the Leaf Genin continued. Sakura, his onyx eyes gazed directly into her emerald ones. Please don't ask me not to fight Naruto again. Sasuke stated, his eyes never wavered as he spoke. The girl was perplexed by the raven-haired boy's request. She struggled to find something that would change his mind, that would stop her teammates from fighting each other. Anything that she might have been able to say was silenced when the Uchiha placed a hand on her shoulder. Sasuke tried to manage a comforting look to calm his teammate. Naruto and I will fight someday, he said. But I promise you, that until then, we will still be Team 7, we will still all be friends. The boy's words came out in a quiet voice. Hearing the sincerity in the Uchiha's words, all the girl could do was nod. A small half-smile formed in Sasuke's lips. I'll keep on training, just as I'm sure Naruto will. I don't know how long it would take or how we will be when it finally comes, so don't worry about it, we will still be here for you, okay? The raven-haired boy said as gave the girl's shoulder a reassuring squeeze. The Leaf Kunoichi nodded in response before looking up and smiling herself. Meeting the smile with another half, Sasuke removed his hand from the pink-haired girl's shoulder before turning around and starting to walk away. And who knows, the Sharingan user stopped for a second. Naruto and I might have to face each other for leadership of the Uchiha clan, maybe our fight would not be until then. He added before reassuming his walk back to the Uchiha compound. Sakura pressed her hands against her heart. She still had many mixed feelings about the situation between her teammates, but for now, she could smile with the thought that maybe things were starting to finally improve. Sakura? The pink-haired girl thoughts were cut off by the sound of her name. Turning around, she found herself facing her former teacher. Iruka walked towards Team 7 carrying a worried look on his face. "What's wrong?" Sakura asked, realizing how foolish her question had sounded after all that had happened. The Chunin seemed to struggle to find the correct words for what he needed to say. "It's about Naruto," he finally said. The mention of his altered student caught Kakashi's attention. "What happened?" Despite what he showed to his two other students, the Jounin was really concerned about Naruto. After everything that had happened, the silver-haired still had not been able to muster enough courage to face his blonde student. Iruka found himself struggling to answer the Jounin too. He still couldn't help but think that Kakashi was partly to blame for what happened to Naruto a few months ago. It had broken his heart to find how broken the one radiant boy had been left. Flashback. Despite telling himself that he only stopped there for his former student, Iruka had to admit that had come to thoroughly love Ichiraku Ramen. Nearing the ramen bar, the Chunin was not surprised to find a familiar blonde seating next to many empty bowls. It didn't take long for the Chunin's eyes to become aware of the lack of bright orange in the boy's clothing, as well as the sullen expression that should have been impossible with a bowl of ramen in such close proximity. Iruka-san, the man turned at the sound of his name. The owner's daughter, Aim, if he wasn't mistaken, had approached him with a worried look on her face. "What's wrong?" Iruka asked, sensing the young lady's distress. The girl's eyes shifted momentarily to gaze at the blonde boy at the other side of the bar, before looking back at the Chunin. "It's Naruto," she started. "He's been like this since he came. He simply sat down and ordered. He didn't make any of his usually conversation with Otu-san," and Miaim explained rapidly under her breath, trying to prevent Naruto to realize she was talking about him. "Calm down," was the first thing Iruka managed to say. "I'm sure it's not that bad." All he said was thank you when Otu-san told him that the ramen was on the house the girl revealed. Iruka's eyes widened at that piece of information. He could clearly recall all those days of detention where Naruto had spent hours talking about how much he liked ramen. The dish had become some sort of a solace in the cruel world that the young boy was forced to live in. While other people might dismiss it with the idea that the boy just wasn't in the mood for ramen, Iruka knew better. Aim took another glance at Naruto. "I'm worried about him, Iruka-san," she confessed. "This is the first time he came in over a month and he's like this. What if something happened during a mission and he..." "Please, Aim-san, don't bother Iruka-sensei with such a trivial matter," the young lady yelped at the blonde genin's words. Iruka's eyes traveled towards his former student to find him looking back at them from his seat. A gasp escaped the older shinobi as he realized how much the boy's eyes had changed. Once vibrant and shining sapphire orbs had become dark and sullen. The smile that had taken shape in the boy's face was nothing but a pitiable shell of what it used to be. Iruka suddenly felt like the night had become darker at the thought of losing Naruto's smile. "I'm sorry, I can't stay and talk, Iruka-sensei, but it's late and I have training tomorrow," the genin suddenly said and begun to stand up. "See you later, Iruka-sensei," Naruto said, giving the older man a small courteous bow. "Ichiraku-san, Aim-san, good night," he gave two more bows and another empty smile, before turning around and walking off. The Chunin was left speechless. That's what I was talking about," Iruka registered Aim's quiet whisper. Not wasting any time, the leaf nin turned around and started off towards the one person that would know what had happened to the once energetic blonde. He had never made such a short time to the Hokage's tower. End flashback. Iruka had been left shocked, saddened, enraged, and concerned after what the late Sandame had revealed to him. Unfortunately, the only person he had for an outlet now was the silver-haired nin. If it hadn't been for his complete disregard for his student, Naruto wouldn't have. Realizing where the Chunin's train of thought was, Kakashi immediately looked away. The Jounin didn't want to be reminded of all the wrongs he had done during the past few weeks. The fact that he still had not found the strength to do anything about it did not help at all. Reminding himself of the matter at hand, the brown-haired man decided to disregard the silver-haired Jounin for now and turned to face Sakura again. "I was worried when he never showed up to the service," Iruka started to explain. "I asked around and it appears that he was seen going towards the training fields right before the ceremony started. I'm concerned about how he's dealing with this whole situation. Normally, I would go see him myself, but I," the Chunin turned around. Sakura followed the older man's gaze to the Sandame's grandson, who stood at the other side of the walkway with a grief-filled face. "I promised Azuma that I would walk Konohamaru home," the Chunin informed. "So, could you please check on him? Just to see how he's dealing with everything that has happened," the brown-haired man requested. The pink-haired girl didn't hesitate to nod. Of course, Iruka-sensei, in fact, I'm a little worried about him as well. She responded. Iruka gave his former student a smile of gratitude. Thank you, Sakura. Well, I better take Konohamaru back to his house now. Please tell me if something happens with Naruto, okay? He said and waited for the girl to nod in agreement before turning around and walking towards the grief-stricken boy, sending a glare in Kakashi's direction during the process. I'll be going home too, the silver-haired man suddenly said. Iruka had reminded him yet again of how unfit of a sensei he had been during the past couple of months, how he had left two of the most important persons in his life, and how his student had ended up paying for his mistake. The jounin just felt like being alone to sulk. See you later, Sakura, he added, excusing himself before starting to walk away. The young Kunoichi couldn't help but think that her teacher's voice felt quiet and weak. Okay, Kakashi-sensei, she said, not sure if he could hear her, but nevertheless she tried to keep any blame from her words, even if a part of her heart felt otherwise. Shaking her head, Sakura turned around and set off towards the training field. We'll arrive there in a couple of days, Kisame waited a couple of seconds for a reply, receiving none, the former Miss Nin continued. News have already spread about the attack the village suffered at the hands of sand, and sound still, the retort was absent. Like it takes some sort of genius to realize that this is all Orochimaru's doing, I mean, they even found the Kazekage's corpse already well into decomposition. He added. The blue-skinned shinobi waited yet again, but no matter how much time passed or how long they walked, his partner remained silent. Sighing, Kisame looked to his side. Itachi Uchiha walked silently next to him with his eyes set on the road. You've been really preoccupied as of late. The missing nin commented. I'm not sure if I want to infiltrate Konoha while your mind is drifting somewhere else. You don't have to worry about that, the Uchiha suddenly spoke for the first time in a couple of days. I already have several plans for infiltrating and escaping the village. The former Leaf Shinobi assured. Kisame couldn't help but snort at his partner's words. And here I thought we were just going to wing it. The Kiri said. You know, Jiraiya is supposed to be in Konoha, what should we do about him? The missing nin wondered as he looked at his partner again. The black-haired man's face showed no concern about the legendary Sannin. His presence in the village has been taken in consideration during the formulation of our mission. The Sharingan user stated. We will act accordingly to what we need to do in order to accomplish our objective. He callously added. A sigh escaped Kisame. Just once, I wished that involved staying the night in a brothel to accomplish the task. He commented, before letting out a long yawn. Anyways, I'll be fine as long as I get first row seat to the Uchiha family reunion. The man added as a grin appeared in his face, and he glazed at his partner. Itachi had already returned to absolute silence. She moved as quietly as her genin skills would allow her. Sakura was so deep into the training area that she had no idea what field she was exactly in, whichever it would have to be near the edge of the forest. After several minutes of searching around, the pink-haired girl was finally able to catch a trace of her blonde teammate's chakra and followed it deeper into the training fields. Her uneasiness increased with every step she took. Apart from their interaction, or lack thereof, in the Forest of Death, she had not actually talked to Naruto since the boy's transformation. The Kunoichi really didn't know what she was going to say when she was face to face with the blonde, she didn't even know that she could expect to find when she got there, which, if the intense chakra in the surroundings was any indicator, was right about now. A gasp escaped Sakura when she stepped into the training field where the chakra had led her. Black flames, that was all that she could think about. The terms kept resonating in her mind time and time again as she gazed around the clearing. The flames that she had seen only twice in her life, once in the Forest of Death and the other during the wild fight against Gaara, both time it had been produced by Naruto. Her eyes immediately moved to the middle of a clearing where her teammate stood. There were no sobs, no shouts of anger, no gritting of teeth, there was only a low breathing as he stood rigidly before the black flames, observing them as they devoured all the surrounding trees. Sakura took small steps towards the blonde, slowly approaching him until she mustered enough courage. Naruto, the girl whispered. The boy made no acknowledgement of her presence, but merely stood there, watching the dark flames overwhelm anything they touched and reducing it to ashes. Naruto. The pink-haired girl tried again, this time with a little more confidence. A small jerk of a hand and a slight shift between feet was proof enough that he was aware of her presence, but that was enough for her. Is it over? The question caught her off guard. His voice was so low and void of emotions that she was left slightly startled, and it took her a few moments to answer his question. Yes, it ended a little while ago, the Kunoichi managed to say. Naruto went completely silent after that. The blonde simply continued watching the flames burn the training field to the ground. She couldn't take it anymore. How was it possible that, when one teammate was finally opening out, the other was shutting himself away? It was obvious to her how the blonde was drowning in sorrow, and yet he wouldn't even try to reach out for help, but instead sealed his emotions off and tried to bear the pain of loss by himself. Pushing her audacity to the limit, Sakura reached out and laid her hand on the spiky-haired boy's shoulder. It was a slow movement, but the action left the Kunoichi astonished anyway. Moments after her hand touched the blonde's shoulder, a silence overcame the clearing, but, suddenly, slowly but surely, her teammate started to turn around. When they finally came face to face, Sakura gazed at the boy in front of her as his head slowly descended until it was resting on her shoulder. A skipped heartbeat was barely registered as she was left frozen by the impossibility of her situation. Sakura needed a few moments to recover, but she was finally able to regain control of her body and moved her arms to embrace the distraught blonde in front of her into a comforting hug. She wanted to let him know that he wasn't alone. Yes, he had lost someone important, but he still had people that cared for him. She wanted him to be able to feel secure once again. Suddenly, she felt water running down her shoulder. It had stopped raining for a while now, nevertheless the pink-haired girl glanced up at the sky, only to find a dissipating cloud starting to give way to the sun. The Kunoichi's eyes widened as she looked to her side at grieving blonde. Is he? It's going to rain again. Naruto's voice was just as even and stoic as before. A small smile graced the girl's face. Yes, she agreed. It seems that it will. The pink-haired nin said as she tightened her hold on her teammate. He was surprised that a smile found its way to his face so soon. Jiraiya sighed as he watched the two genin in the middle of the clearing before turning around and starting to walk away. Looking down, he regarded the scroll bestowed upon him merely a few hours before the catastrophe. If you gave them to me, then I assume that you trust my judgment one when he should get it. The Sanin said as he continued to walk. The brat still has some growing up to do, but he looked back at the clearing for a second. I'm sure he'll get there. The white-haired man commented. I'm sure this generation will do just fine. Jiraiya stated as he looked up into the sky. You can just rest now and don't worry about them, they'll live up to all of our expectations. I guess that's because of your influence on them. Another smile formed on his lips. Thanks, old geezer. So that's it for today, guys. I will stop here. I hope did you enjoy this one. If you do, please leave a like, share and subscribe. So thanks for watching.